7th floor. And afterwards, there are several GenSpace members that will make an announcement. You can go up and tour GenSpace if you'd like. GenSpace is actually too small to hold this crowd. We're very excited that it is such a big crowd. GenSpace is a place for people to get access to the sorts of technologies that just a few years ago were only available to scientists and labs, some of which were things that won people the Nobel Prize. And now they're filtering down to the high school level, they're filtering down to the community level. And my personal dream is that in the future, everyone will know, have at least a working knowledge of these technologies, the same way you have a working knowledge of electricity. Because these technologies are going to bleed into every aspect of your lives. Can somebody answer my phone, please, and tell them someone's coming? Okay. So GenSpace was established when we moved into this building and actually opened the lab in 2010. We teach classes for the general public, hands-on classes where you can learn genetic engineering and synthetic biology. We have lab memberships, so if you get inspired to do a project, you can actually come and do your own project. We do this at a very low price point to encourage people to do it. It's $100 a month, and you have access to a working lab with all the equipment and a lot of shared supplies. We also do things like we partner with other nonprofits that are providing STEM education. We provide a place for people to do scientific competitions. So right now we're running an iGEM team, which is the International Genetically Engineered Machine Competition. And we do a lot of other things. We have talks like this very often. So check our website. The talks are free. We also have an open night once a month where we do PCR and pizza. This is a trend that's going to continue in the future because I must get a call at least once every 2 or 3 weeks of somebody who wants to try and open another community lab in a different country or a different part of this country. And right now there must be at least a dozen working labs scattered across the country. There are several in California, there's one in Boston, there's one in Baltimore, Montreal, Atlanta. I think just about every major city could benefit from having a space like this because even a professional scientist, if you tell them that there's a place where they can just do their work and they don't have to worry about whether or not it's going to make money or save mankind, or even if it's going to, you know, potentially work or not. It's just a freedom to tinker with this sort of stuff. Their eyes light up, because that's why most of us got into science to begin with, is the ability to experiment and try new things. So the only rule we have is it has to be within certain safety guidelines. But aside from that, you can pretty much do whatever you want. That plus the very interdisciplinary crowd that we attract, everything from artists, programmers, to professional biologists, students, entrepreneurs, VCs. We've got anyone in our classes from, you know, lawyers to janitors to teachers to bioinformaticians. This makes for a very interesting mix of people, artists. So anyway, we support ourselves through classes and memberships and donations. There is a donation box on the table at the booth. We would be thrilled if you would put a couple bucks in the donation box before you leave. We also have, what? At least 10, yes, I'll offer. We also have a mailing list if you'd like to sign up for that. We won't spam you, we won't sell the mailing list. We probably send out maybe 2 or 3 emails a month, and they're all about events that are happening. So if you'd like to be on the mailing list and you're not already, go ahead and sign up for that. Okay, enough about GenSpace. This is very exciting. This is the first time we've had actually two synthetic biologists in the same room. We're delighted to have Dr. Paul Freemont, who is from Imperial College in London, and is very, very active in synthetic biology as it impacts the world in general. He's someone who's been helping out here. But I mean, really, this is an emerging technology, and as such, there are all sorts of things: how do governments view it, how do not-for-profits view it, how do advocacy groups view it. Is it going to be labeled the same as genetic engineering? How does the general public feel about it? Because any very powerful technology carries with it a certain amount of risk, and so Bob has been very, he's been an advocate for the technology, and in a way, though, that is very respectful with the general public and physicians, which it's a little bit even more heightened in the UK, because they're very much against genetic engineering food, for example, much more so than the United States. So it's going to be very interesting to hear Paul's experiences. And then we have Dr. Natalie Kuldell, who was one of the people that developed the first program to teach this new biological engineering at MIT, and was so thrilled with it that she felt that it was actually a very, very good way to teach people about science in general. And so she's created a novel program called Biobuilder, which takes it down to the level of high school and even pre-high school. So I guess without further ado, I'm going to let Paul take the floor.
Thank you.
Oh, and Karen. Sorry, Karen, sorry. This is terrible. And in partnership with Karen Ingram, who's a dead space member and a designer, they've just come out with a wonderful book, which is really a primer on synthetic biology, and which you all will have an opportunity to look at and potentially buy.
So I'm going to start my talk with a series of what ifs. I just want to get you thinking about the possibilities of the future of this technology. So the first one is, you know, what if you had a probiotic drink and you drank that every morning, and then you went to the bathroom and you looked at the color of your feces, and that told you how well you were doing, you know, whether you needed to go to the doctor or your health state is, okay? That was an E-chromite, cheap personalized disease monitoring from the inside out. What if you could take all of this stuff, landfill waste, and convert it into recyclable bioplastics so that you could essentially build things that you want through 3D printing or whatever? You could take all your rubbish and convert it into these items. What if you could engineer plants and trees to kind of absorb sunlight during the day? And then at night they could emit sort of bioluminescence, and you could actually, you know, light the whole city based on a natural photosynthetic process. And you could also use it for reading. What if you could take little yeast cells or bacteria cells, and you could then kind of grow them up and then have this wonderful material called bacterial cellulose? And what if you could make clothes out of that? And what if you could take them and put them into filters for your water or for other sorts of things like that? What if you could take yeast, baker's yeast, right? The thing we use to make bread, to make alcohol. What if you could essentially redesign it? Let's just take the program, and let's just make the program much more easier to run and allow us to make things from yeast. And there's a meeting in New York about that tomorrow. What if we could take genetic circuits, which we could then impregnate on the paper, little filter strips, and you could dip your filter paper into a liquid, and the liquid would absorb up and then change color based on maybe there's a virus in that, maybe there's a parasite, maybe there's a bacteria, whatever. So this paper-based filter of biosensors. What if you could take all this stuff, which we really don't want, petroleum, coal, natural gas, what if you could change that into, you know, sunlight, carbon dioxide, into lignocellulose waste, and make all of these products? These are sort of stuff that we take for granted. These are all the sort of things that go into everything in this room. Everything in the world is made of these chemical building blocks, pretty much, synthetic chemical building blocks. We need to keep making these if we want to have products, so we need to change what we're doing. And what if we could take our waste? So in the UK, and I'm sure in New York, you have to take your organic waste from your own homes and then it gets collected and it gets taken out and used or recycled, whatever. What if you take it at home and have some sort of, I put down here, gen space yeast, right? Some engineered yeast that you could take that, put it in some sort of fermentation jars and start making your own products. Maybe you want to make your own perfume, maybe you want to make food flavors, maybe you want to make dyes. That would be a really cool thing to do. Right, so those what-ifs all sound a bit fanciful, but actually a lot of those what-ifs are actually now turning into realities. Several of those projects are all from iGEM, that's the project that is going on down here actually, and a lot of those projects have set the seeds for this new technology called synthetic biology. And so, like every new technology, it has a sort of formalized definition. And I guess the formalized, acceptable definition for a lot of people is it aims to design, it aims to engineer biological-based parts, devices, and systems, and as well as redesigning the existing natural world. And at one time in the world, there was more brochures and strategy documents and future prospect documents from all over the world than actual fundamental scientific publications. It was a really unusual time in the technology development. Every country has a brochure on synthetic biology and opportunities. Okay, so what, if you want to make it a bit easier, really what it wants to do is to make the engineering of biology much more predictable, much more accessible, and much more simpler. And there's a great book, which you're going to hear about in a minute, Biobuilder, which is trying to address that, making this technology accessible to everyone so they can start, you know, doing stuff. We have an undergraduate book we wrote as well. So modern biotechnology is not bad. You know, it's done pretty well. We take it for granted. It's been around a long time. A lot of stuff that I like, comes from modern biotechnology. But of course, there are medicines. There are all sorts of really important stuff that's done. But the trouble is, it's a pretty bespoke process. So a lot of people say, well, you know, this is biology new. We've got biotechnology. We don't need it. What is all this about, right? Why is it so new? So really, I think it's happening, and I'm going to show you about it, because there are some kind of increased knowledge base of what biology is at very different levels. There's also the idea, and this is really helpful, of bringing systematic design and engineering into biological systems at the genetic level. That is totally unique. That's never been done before, and that's what's happening with synthetic biology. And of course, the other kind of biotech that I'm used to is this 30, 40 year old technology which has been bespoke, there's no standards, it's an extraordinary industry. Every industry I know has standards, right? Biotechnology has no industrial standards. Why is that? Because it's a really weird technology that, you know, if you're clever enough, you can make it work. It's just crazy. But we have been using biology for 5,000 years, or longer, actually. Making wine in 1,500 years before the birth of Christ, that's quite a long time ago. Making animals domesticated, making bread, planting crops. We've been using biology continuously as an evolution of human beings. So the natural extension of that is to start redesigning and engineering biology for useful purposes, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So now I'm just going to if I get going, I'll just go, so you need to bring me down, challenge, question, whatever you want. But let me tell you a little bit about why now. So why at this particular point in history and time, do we have place like gen space? Do we have some biology? What's going on? So there was an amazing 30 years, I think, between 1953 and 1981. And in that period of time, we learned the structure of DNA, which was a fundamental breakthrough in the understanding of living systems. We then learned how to move DNA around, how to clone it, how to manipulate it. And then we learned in the extraordinary period of how to read it, actually read the genetic code. What is that about? And then perhaps to totally close this loop, in 1981 we learned how to write it, how to synthesize it, how to chemically make DNA. That's an amazing period of time, and that is probably leading to where we are now. Now, 60 years later, we've got the genome sequences of pretty much every major organism on the planet. So that's the instruction sets for every living system, and you can get your genome sequence, I guess, maybe less than $10,000, maybe less than $1,000, whatever. But you can, this is now an accessible technology. Reading DNA is done. It's a done deal. We can do it. So what, why, you know, what's the big deal about this molecule? You know, why is it so special? Why is it so important? You know, why, you know, in every newspaper around the world, people will say, you know, they'll use DNA in their own everyday English language. You know, it's in their DNA. Or the team, the sports team DNA, you know, they, this is a pretty iconic molecule. So let's just explore it for a few minutes, see where we get to. The reason it's iconic, if you like, and really fundamental, is that it essentially encodes all the instructions for living systems on planet Earth. And I really hope before I die that someone comes back from Mars and brings a piece of DNA. I just want to know that there's DNA on Mars. I really want to know that. So please, NASA, please, someone, just do it. Because, you know, if we were to find DNA like this on Mars, it opens up an extraordinary, you know, philosophical avenue of thought. Anyway, this is the molecule that is essentially instructing all living systems. So what is it? You know, why is it so special? It's really simple. It's got four building blocks, and they're shown here, four chemical building blocks linked together in a long chain. And the really cool thing about DNA is that one building block completely interacts with the other. So G, guanine, always interacts with C, always. And A always interacts with T, adenine, thymine. So when you build up this to double strand of DNA, right, these chemical building blocks, they all pair up, which means that you can replicate it very easily. If you know if you've got one strand, you know what the other strand will be. That's a key fundamental point. So what we do is we write this code like this, single letters, G, C, A, T, G, C, A, T, and that's essentially what the genetic code is. And there are a few extraordinary facts about DNA, and I can't resist you and tell you. So 1 million bases of DNA sequence, 1 million of these kind of bases, okay, is essentially equivalent to about a megabyte of computer data storage space, okay? Humans have got 3 million bases in each cell, so one of your cells, essentially the DNA in it, is essentially equivalent to 3 megabytes of computer storage space. I think that's really cool. If you were to unwrap all the DNA from your cells, okay, you're a human being, you could string it all out and you could go to the moon 6,000 times of that when you unstring this molecule. It's an extraordinarily amazing molecule. And there's a great website with 100 facts of DNA, which I definitely should go read. Okay, so it's essentially the operating system for living systems. So now we're getting into this kind of programmability side of it. But I really want to just spend the next few minutes, if I can, just to tell you a little bit about, you know, how do you translate it? How does the code translate, okay? Also, what does it look like? Okay, so this is a really easy experiment. You can take strawberries, you can treat them with detergent, you can put some acid in, put some ethanol. Extract this material here, which is essentially DNA. So you can see it, you know, there's white stuff that cracks up. Strawberries have got the most extraordinary amount of DNA. If you want to, you know, just chop a block full of DNA. Okay, so let's talk about the code for a bit. I just want to run through this a few things. I'm going to compete with the fire engine. There's obviously some great big fire around there. This is more than that, Tom. Yes, it is. So, right, how do we translate it, right? So we've got this code, runs every living system. One of the key questions is, how do we translate it? How is the code translated? And unfortunately, that kind of gets glossed over a lot. You kind of say, oh, well, it gets translated, something happens, whatever. I want to just run through this, spend 2 minutes with you, and take you through how this code is translated. It's so fundamentally important. The code is DNA. It goes through an intermediate molecule called RNA, and it produces proteins. It's a central dogma of molecular biology. So the code produces proteins. So how does it do that? So on this little jiffy here, you'll see, here is our DNA code, okay? And what we want to do is we want to make this intermediate molecule called RNA. And what happens is a machine comes in, a big protein machine, and it will zip along here. And it will copy the code, as it's doing there. Remember that G goes with C and A goes with T. There is a slight difference in RNA, because the T is a U, but let's not forget about that. And that's how you produce this intermediate molecule. So you essentially copy one strand of DNA, you make the messenger RNA, and that's the message, okay? That's a really key part of the process, okay? So then, the next bit is how you translate the message, okay? So another big machine comes in, and this time it only looks at three bases, three units, okay? And what it does is it brings another molecule to play that only recognizes those three units. molecules. And these molecules are called tRNAs, and they have got amino acids. And this machine called a ribosome links all these amino acids together to form proteins. So you now know how the code is translated. From those simple graphs, that's how it's done, okay? You make the message, you copy it, and then you make proteins, and that's it. Nothing more. You're done. That's it. You're all molecular biologists now. But let's kind of look at proteins for 1 second. The really beautiful thing about diversity is that proteins, which are everything, they do everything in the cell. They make stuff, they form the structures of cells, they just do everything. And that's the product of the DNA code, okay? They have 20 amino acids, right? 20 naturally occurring amino acids, and that's where this diversity comes. So you have these long strings of amino acids that all fold up into these proteins. And that's where the genetic code essentially is so diverse and so unique. It codes for these different kind of amino acids. Now, I'm going to indulge a little bit more. This is a really cool movie from Cold Spring Harbor. So this is now making proteins in real time. So here's this messenger RNA coming out, okay? And you're going to see this kind of movie. And this movie is based on a lot of detailed molecular knowledge of the machine. So here's the ribosome coming on board. So this is the messenger RNA, okay? And those are those little tRNAs I showed you, right? That are recognizing the three little bases. And these tRNAs are bringing amino acids, and the amino acids are being linked together. So those are tRNAs, those are amino acids, okay? So they're floating around, they lock in on the ribosome, they lock down, and the ribosome moves along, boom, boom, boom. And this code goes along at 20 amino acids per second. So it's quite a lot. So it's joining 20 units per second. When you see it again in a minute, you'll see it in real time. Those are the amino acids there. So each tRNA has a different amino acid, a little chemical building block. So here's a ribosome again, tRNAs are coming in, there they are, flying on. That's real time. So that's experimentally real time. That's how we think it works. Now, each one of you has got billions of cells, and in each cell you've got hundreds of thousands of these ribosomes producing proteins in every cell. So this is going on in every living system now, okay? And out of this thing comes this protein, and this protein's going to boom, fold, okay? I'll just let it run for a little while and then we'll move on. And the protein's going to, this actually protein's called myoglobin, which is the protein that carries oxygen around your blood. And here it's just going to go spontaneously fold when it comes and then finish. And that's the end of the translation of the code, okay? Well, we'll move on, okay? So you get the feel, right? So, you know, you have the DNA, you have the messenger RNA, then you make the proteins, and all of these machines are there to do it. Okay, so that's real time. Now, so that's sort of the basics. So you can really relax now because that's the hardest bit over. You're all now, you know, you all know how to make proteins, right? You just use the code. Here's why now too. Why we have synthetic biology. So this is the Carlson curve. So this is a really interesting curve. So Rob Carlson showed that the cost as a function of time is decreasing rapidly for reading DNA. Okay, that's sequencing DNA. That's why it's so cheap to get your genome sequence if you want. But the trouble is that writing DNA, synthesizing DNA, it's actually sort of coming down in price, but it hasn't reached this kind of step point here, which allows everyone to sort of, you know, essentially design DNA, hit return, and back comes a synthetic piece of DNA to my design. But that will happen potentially. There's a new company called Twist Biosciences, and it looks as if the technology is coming down the pipe, but this is going to actually go boom down. And when that does happen, and I don't know when it will, that's going to be a very different world. That's the world where design is going to be the key, and the DNA synthesis is just going to be done by the technology. Governments are also interested, and the reason is because of the global market of synthetic biology technologies. So this World Economic Forum, $12 billion by 2018. Who knows? But a lot of governments are interested in this. So synthetic biology is engineering biology. So now we're going to go a little bit into the engineering side. I need to give an hour of time because I can talk forever. So the engineering is really cool. So that's the bit that is really, really different. This is not molecular biology, this is engineering biology. So let's think about engineered systems, right? They tend to be quite robust, hopefully, you know, they tend to work and robustly work. They have stability, generally, and those sort of stability and robustness of engineered systems tends to be attributed to a number of different factors. System control, redundancy in the engineered system, modular design and structural stability are kind of key classic, you know, parts of an engineered complex system. Okay, what about biology? Do we have, biology's complex, right? Do we have similar features? We do. So what do we have? System control in a cell. There are feedback processes going on all the time. There are sensing systems about how the cell is and how it should be. Do we have redundancy? Yeah, we do. We've got multiple copies of genes that do similar things. We have redundancy in our system. Do we have modular design? We do, because there are evolutionary robust units of genetic material which we share with other species. They're modular in that process. Do we have structural stability? Well, we do have stable gene regulatory units. Now, clearly things go wrong with humans, like cancer, disease, all of that, genetic-based diseases, right? But in general, we have features of complex systems. And the question is, are these intrinsic features of complex systems, whether they're artificial or biological? So synthetic biology will really address that issue, because we're going to now consider biological systems as engineered systems. So how do we design and construct new biological systems and cells using synthetic biology, right? What's the big difference here? How are we going to do it? So as I said, systems are modular, right? The biological function is coded DNA. I showed you that. I showed you how the DNA code works. There's a huge database of genome sequences, I showed you that as well. Large diversity of biological parts, increased understanding of biology, and now technologies that allow us to manipulate. However, this is a big however. Biological systems are complex and multi-scale, right? So on the left here is a metabolic pathway, that's all a chemical pathway, it's not complete, but that's in a simple organism, that's the chemistry that's going on. There are spatial organization, there are proteins involved, there are molecular details involved, and of course the other thing about living systems is that they live. So there's a fourth dimension called time. So things change and they're dynamic and nonlinear. So they're very complex systems if you were to begin to engineer. It's like, okay, so it's like an engineer building a bridge, and then, you know, after a period of time, the weather, you know, maybe there's a thunderstorm, and then the bridge changes its form to cope with the environmental things, starts buckling or something. That would be really weird, right? But that's what biology does. It's very adaptive, it's plastic, it's responsive. And so how do you engineer something that is, you know, so adaptable? Big challenge. Complex, spatially complex, inside a cell, it's contained, it's really full of molecules, really concentrated stuff. And also it's non-linear. Biological systems are not meant to be non-linear. They're not meant to, you know, act and so events happen, and that's how evolution works. That's why we are where we are, because some spontaneous random event occurred which allows a genetic alteration, which allows a fitness of a species or whatever to occur. So they're non-linear. And then the last bit on complexity is the kind of scale, biological scale. So we're down at the molecules, right? We saw those machines I showed you, tiny little machines, right? Really, really nanometer in length scale. And then we work all the way up to whole communities, you know, not just human being communities, but communities of organisms that live and cohabitate. And so the scale issue is absolutely ginormous. It's a bit like the equivalent of physics, if you like, from the, not quite, but from the micro to the kind of big stuff. So biology has a similarly challenging scale. Okay, so, but there is a way forward, right? And I think the way forward is that we need to start standardizing biological processes. We need to start standardizing our research. And the reason we need to do that even more than ever is that there's a very interesting report that came out a few years back showing that at least, I don't know whether the number is right or not, but greater than 60 or 70% of published research, all publicly funded, is not reproducible in biological and biomedical research. Now, you know, I talked to my physics colleagues and my engineering colleagues about this, and they just can't believe that my community would accept this irreproducibility of our research. But it's a very common problem. You know, biological research is highly reproducible. It's crazy. So how do we deal with overcome complexity, irreproducibility? How do we get there? The answer is systematic design and engineering. Okay, so let's build our engineering framework. So in engineering, we have these abstraction hierarchies. So if you're coding at a very high level, you don't really need to worry about the machine code. If you're a computer scientist or just a coder, right, you don't really need to know how the chip's working. So the way that synthetic biology is trying to deliver this kind of, you know, framework is that people can work at different abstraction hierarchies, different levels. So at the bottom here is the DNA, that's the machine code. I showed you how the machine code works, okay, how it's translated. But I really don't need to understand that if I want to start designing parts, I want to put parts together. And I really don't need to understand maybe how these parts work and I want to build a device, and that's how engineers work. So the idea of synthetic biology lets build this framework of abstraction hierarchy in engineering. The other really cool thing about this approach is that you can start building engineering design cycles into what you do. This has never been done in biological research. You can construct things, you can build things, you can design things. So the design-build-test part cycle here is so key to synthetic biology. I can't overemphasize it. So this is where we're going to get all of our knowledge on biological systems from in the future, is how we design them, how we build them, how they work, and how do we learn from that, and then go around this cycle. And the reason that that's powerful is because you're sitting there saying, well, I want to build something that does something, and I'm going to build it based on these parts, and I'm going to put these parts together, and I think they should work. I've done my computer, I've done my literature database searching, I've done everything, but I put them together, and I put them in a cell, and it doesn't work. So what do you do? How do you debug it? Where do I go next? Okay, you've got to start going around this cycle. You've got to start saying, well, let's measure things, let's have some idea about what could be wrong, what could be right. And then you can start really, you know, sort of learning about the design principles of living systems, which is what we're trying to do. So a design, you know, a workflow in synthetic biology could be something like this, where you're sitting there with a library of biological parts. You're sort of designing things about, you know, I want to make a cell, like a sensing cell. So I've got these genetic parts I can put together, and I want to do some modeling. Oh yeah, it looks like it might work, let's build it. And that's still painful, but let's build it. And then let's test it and measure and see how my design worked and then go around the cycle. And this is what synthetic biologists are trying to achieve now. Now the reason that we're doing that is because this is a beautiful slide, and it's embarrassing because it's data from an undergraduate practical where we've got a whole bunch of students who are essentially expressing GFP and measuring, and they're all in a class, a bit like, you know, any class anywhere in the world. And you give them the construct, you put it in the cell, follow this process, and measure the fluorescence protein. Look at the error bars on here. I mean, these are crazy, right? This is not biological irreproducibility. This is human beings trying to, you know, do stuff, if you like. And this is sort of supposedly top undergraduates, but obviously not very good undergraduates. You probably can share your experiences as well. So this is why we need to sort this out. So we have adopted the approach of automation. And I would fairly recommend people who are interested in synthetic biology to look into automation as a way of standardizing their processes, how they can start thinking about standardizing all of the biological build, all the testing, and all the metrology. This is one of our very early platforms we developed for how we could characterize biological parts in an automatic high-throughput way. And it's a very simple, you know, very ancient robot. But we've now learned from that. And we started building data sheets, okay? So this is these are promoters, and we wanted to imagine that we were into sort of electronic components, so each part would be highly characterized. We have all the metadata, all the measurement data, we have the sequence, the cell that we measured it in, the temperature, all that. So these are a lot of data in here, and the idea is that these would be highly standardized, highly professionalized, characterized parts. Now we've moved on. This is our latest characterization platform that we've just built in Sydney City at Imperial College in London. And this is now, you know, moving us into another level of throughput and automation. So these are the foundations, if you like, for engineering biology. You've got, you know, parts, devices. You know, you want standard measurements. We want to build systems. We need to define the cells that we're going to run our systems in. And we need to make kind of cellular factories, if you like, cellular devices. So there is this concept, which I think is really important, which everyone can grab, I think. This is a very accessible concept. And that is the idea that foundational technology in synthetic biology can actually deliver many different application spaces. So what we're focusing on a lot is, what is the foundational technology that will make the whole field move to a different level? Now, at the moment, a lot of the foundational technology developments are around the biochem tools, the design tools, the computational tools, for how you can build DNA, how you can design DNA, and how you can model functionality. There's a lot of work going on in that. There's quite a lot of work on DNA synthesis and assembly. It's still painful, but you're doing, if I want to make, you know, in the future, I want to make, you know, 100 designs, you know. I don't want to make one design, or two, or 10, I want to make 100. Ideally, I want to make 1,000 designs. Sort of learn about that test build cycle. We just can't do that now. It's just technologically not possible. then we want to develop really strong metrology. How do we measure parts? How do we do dark systems that don't work? You know, we need to learn that. And then the other thing we really need to grasp with is how do we really get to grips with I really hope it's not a bad fire, that was terrible. How do we get to grips with cells? You know, the stuff that we're running the programs in. We need to understand the basics of the cells. We need to make some, you know, the ideal scenario would be a standardized E. coli strain that GenSpace works on, we work on, people at MIT work on, everyone knows what they're working on. We don't have that now. Okay, so these are all the tools available. They're not up to date, but you can go on the web and you can get loads of biodesign tools. If you just type in biodesign, BioCat, you'll find all of these tools that allow you to explore different kind of design frameworks. Some of them are more accessible than others, but you can certainly have a good look at those. So the information flow, I think, is important. So if you're engaging with this technology, you know, where do I get the information from? If you're not in a university or if you're not in professional lab, where do I get stuff from? So obviously scientific publications. In the UK, we're trying to push everything into open source. I don't know if that's the same in the US. But one of the problems we've got is that scientific literature is not accessible to everyone, which is crazy. Databases are accessible, so you can go on all the databases, the sequence databases, and all of the design tools are accessible. So there are information flows that you can get hold of. There are registries of biological parts that you can get hold of. The iGEM registry is the most famous, if you like. And then you can start, you know, thinking about how do I design, build, test, how do I, you know, what am I going to build, how am I going to measure, and all of that sort of stuff. So quite a lot of this is accessible. Probably that, which is really quite annoying, since most of that is publicly funded, is not accessible to the public, which is totally bizarre. Okay, so now I'm going to whip through the next sort of few minutes. I think I'm okay for a few, I'm all right for a bit more. I'm going to whip through kind of where we're at, what are the areas that people are interested in. So there's a whole lot of work on, you know, building devices. So there's a very nice review of all of the devices. You know, some of these devices are quite old now. Trigger switches, DNA-based memory. This is all at the kind of DNA genetic circuit level. There are loads of devices. And more recently, there's been some really cool work on RNA devices, toll-hold ribosomes. They're really, really interesting. And there's a paper that's just come out, which you can get on the web. From the guys up in MIT with a whole bunch of different processes of, you know, regulating at the right of the RNA level. This is Chris Voigt's work, now extending the design space to the operons. These are whole units of genetic circuitry which will produce a function. So this is the nitrogen fixation cluster in Klebsiella. So what Chris did is he refactored that, and he did actually 240 odd different designs of that naturally occurring operon, and then measured the activity, and actually could create up to about 50%, 57% of the wild type activity of the operon, but in a completely different refactored way. So that's a very interesting, land-breaking kind of work. And then of course there are people working on the designing and building at the genome level, okay? So there is the classic Craig Venter mycoplasma genitalium project, which everyone knows about. So that's the Cynthia cell. There's a meeting on Saccharomyces cerevisiae, that's Baker's yeast, tomorrow in New York, the fourth meeting of that consortium, which are hoping to make all of the chromosomes of yeast, synthetic chromosomes. And then there are people working on minimizing the genome, you know, how many genes can I get away with without, you know, and still have a living system. And then there are people, a massive, massive area of genome editing going on at the moment with CRISPR, Cas, and MAGE, all really, really beginning to take off. And then we're designing the protein level. You can design proteins, why not? You know, this is a solenoid protein, it's very predictable, very designable. You can put the sequence in of each one of these repeats and you can produce proteins. And people are thinking about, you know, maybe rational protein design is something useful. Okay, so this slide illustrates the DNA as a programming language, and I show this to really upset all my biological colleagues, which I do quite frequently actually. And that is that they, you know, the idea of going from a computer and then into a cell and something happening and working in a predictable way. My biological colleagues find that very difficult to cope with. Biology is a crossword, you know how to do it, you know, all of this stuff, right? So on the next slide, here's some yeast. And that yeast is producing diesel, biofuel, if you like, pharmacy. And if we now just sort of ignore all the biology and say, well, what are the changes that I needed to make on the genome to make that yeast produce pharmaceutical? So this is a really cool bit of information. So I needed to change about 112 bases. I needed to add that in 112 nucleotides. I needed to remove 41,000. I needed to then change 450 single nucleotide changes. So about 1% of the whole genome was essentially edited or built. And that went from a yeast into a yeast producing very, very high titers of biodiesel. So I find it very difficult now not to believe that, you know, that we can reprogram cells to do things. And when you look at it like that, it's all about the design-build test, which is what Amaris did when they designed this. So programmable factories, I think, is the future. Living sensing devices, there are lots of work going on around biosensors as well. So manufacturing, biosensing, and then therapies. There are some very cool work going on about living therapies. And this particular paper that came out in May this year, showing about, this is coming back to the probiotic thing, where you could take a bacteria, ingest it in an animal, it would then go into the liver and detect cancer cells, and then it would catalyze a chemical reaction, produce a color, which you would detect in the urine. So this is now that beautiful project that was set up by the Cambridge Argentine in 2009, if you like, is now in 2015 a proof of concept reality. That's not a big length of time in science, by the way. That's only 5-6 years. Okay, now in my lab we're working on biosensors for cystic fibrosis patients to detect pseudomonas infections. It's a major problem for those patients, and we want to develop some really cheap sensing diagnostics for that. And we're also working on another biosensor for parasitic disease, and particularly schistosoma, which is a terribly, you know, debilitating disease. And we've worked a way of detecting it's a larvae, it's a parasitic larvae, it lives in fresh water, gets into people, creates something called schistosomiasis, which is a terrible disease. And we want to detect the infected form of the larvae so that when these people are washing or swimming or playing in water, it'd be very good to know if that water has infected larvae or not. And at the moment they don't know that. And what they have to do is they have to go around and collect samples from snails, because the larvae essentially is in the snails. And then they have to go back to a makeshift lab, look under the microscope, and these little white things are the Sicaria larvae. So there's got to be a better way of doing it than that. There just has to be. This is crazy, you know, this kind of process. So what we're trying to develop is a very simple water test that it's iGEM-inspired project, parasite project that we did in Imperial College, where you take the water, you put in a thing, and it goes, changes color when this little parasite is present. So we're now, I won't go into details, but we're now pretty close to having that working. Okay, so in the last 2 minutes, I want to just sort of, you know, there's a big stop here, okay, and this relates to what Ellen's comment was earlier. And I just want to show you a flash through some kind of public media headlines. Okay, so here's the big thing. Synthetic biology is not natural. Keep extreme engineering out of natural products. I don't know what natural is anymore, but anyway. Scientists accused of playing God after creating artificial life by making designer microbe from scratch, but could it wipe out humanity? Home-brewed morphine made possible. Brewing bad. Scientists find ways to cook up heroin at home. I mean, okay, I'm wrong, right? Low-sin bio vanilla. Extreme genetic engineering in your ice cream. What a provocative image that is, right? Race to keep a lid on labs. This is a good one for here, right? Race to keep a lid on labs creating artificial life mid boom in DIY biohackers. Labs need to be monitored, says American Institute. No framework in place to monitor projects. Free labs in New York, Boston, San Francisco are DIY bio. Government should assess DIY community. Natural lighting, but glowing plant, right? Here's a classic project. Okay, glowing plants. Stop glowing plants. Put a stop to synthetic biology pollution. That's another interesting juxtaposition of words, right? We're polluting the world. GMO, stop GMOs on Kickstarter, which they did. So what do we do about this? We have to talk, we have to engage, we have to communicate. You know, we have to really sort of take this on as a personal mission. Every one of us who's in synthetic biology has to take this on. Can't escape it. We've got to get out there, we've got to talk to people and say, well, this is what we're doing. What do you think? You know? Do you like it? Do you think it's good? You know? I mean, we need to think, we need to be responsible of what we're doing. We need to, you know, we need to anticipate things. And, you know, when you're making something in a lab, you're very far removed from what could happen when that product or that, you know, comes online. So we need to anticipate what the social economic implications are, you know, from our designs, if you like. We need to reflect why we're doing it. Why are we doing this? You know, are we there to make a lot of money? It's fine. Are we there to save people? Are we there to, you know, educate people? We just need to know, you know, why we're doing it. You need to know why you're doing it. We need to engage. We need to have dialogue. We need to, you know, discuss. That's what this is about, I guess. And then we need to act. We need to think about, you know, if we come across things, we need to think about how do we act on those thoughts. And it's not about changing public opinion. It's more about, you know, being responsive and adapting the research itself in order to, you know, develop a technology that's socially acceptable. And that's really what we need to do. So everyone who's doing synthetic biology downstairs, and everyone who does it, really needs to be able to answer these questions. You know, what is the purpose of your research? What are you going to gain from it? How will it serve the public interest? How are the risks and benefits likely to be distributed? What are the key uncertainties? And how do you know you are correct? I certainly don't, and I suspect most people don't know they are correct. It's a really difficult question, but it's one you've got to ask yourself. And that's it. Thank you.
So you spoke about the different levels of abstraction, and you come from a computer science background, and the whole way that that works is because at the higher level of abstraction, you know absolutely what the low levels are doing, right?
Right.
So unless there's a lot of crosstalk that's built into whatever system we eventually create as an industry, there's potential there for kind of built-in blind spots, you know, some low-level molecules of interaction that you haven't discovered, and you're throwing everything off, no one would know it. So to give an example, like, if I'm an Apple developer, I'm working in their software expert, and I'm using their libraries, in this case, I would be like a low-level abstraction, and I build something that's all done in production. Even after that, Apple updates its frameworks to deprecate something, which says, hey, that retroactively sort of breaks my project and says, hey, you know, this doesn't do what we thought it did, let's change the things. So we kind of need that, you know, not everyone just working at their own level of abstraction, but some way to communicate through that.
I couldn't agree more. And I think if you read a slide carefully, it's a conceptual framework. Right? So in real engineering, real computer science, it's a framework which is utilized. It's a framework, it's a conceptual framework that allows us to address the biological complexities in a way that is more meaningful, and then we can share knowledge and information about how things work. So the literal, you know, translation of computer programming and chip design or whatever through to biology, I don't think that works.
I guess a quick follow-up is, like, I know there's like, you know, the Biobuilder registry, for example, with this information, like, has there been any work amongst people that are trying to make this an industry-wide protocol standard,
yeah,
to kind of build, like, has there actually been anything built to this effect, you know, like this immediate retroactive sort of communication between different works that point out errors after the fact?
It would be great. I think you've got to just imagine that we're at the point of the transistor in the 1960s or 50s, when people would start building these really weird transistors. Where's that going to go? No one knew. No one knew at that point when they were designing issues and stuff like that. We're going to be going on that level. So, in some senses, we're back there in synthetic biology. So, how it evolves and develops is a very interesting
place. Is there like an official sort of like consortium?
Yeah. So, to address your question, there are standards just beginning to emerge where people are realizing that actually this is an industry and for a future technology, we need to have standard processes, common protocols, standard operating processes, standard measurements. You know, when I measure something, then maybe Matthew measures or someone may, you know, that we can share the measurements and say, well, actually, no, that's similar to what we do. Biology is soft matter. Engineering is soft matter.
I can't hear you.
Sorry. thought I was shouting, sorry. Okay, no, we're engineering soft matter, you know, so, you know, you've got to remember that. This is not, you know, we're not electric circuit boards and, you know, all that stuff.
I'm more kind of talking about, like, persistent documentation that she...
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's a very good question. Thank you for asking.
I take more questions, perhaps.
So, thank you. Let me take just a minute. So I'm Natalie Kuldell, and I'll take just a minute to introduce Karen. And I'll actually start the way my colleague called it. It's nice to see that even across the pond we're asking the same questions. And I'll ask the question, what if? The question that motivates me, the what if question that motivates me, is really, what if science and engineering education better resembled the way we practice science and the way we practice engineering, right? So there is this sort of odd decoupling of how we learn science and how we learn to become engineers and the way that people who are doing this work are actually practicing it and working. And so I see it as a tremendous opportunity in synthetic biology to have this emerging field be something that we explore together, where science and engineering is really about learning from things that don't work, things that are failed, and why that failed, and then making adjustments and going forward. To me, that was always the most exciting part of science and the most interesting part. I think engineers aren't thrilled when things don't work, but I think they also don't get totally derailed by it. They don't expect to have the right answer the first time. In synthetic biology, I'm not sure we have the right answers yet. You know, Paul talked about the complexity of the living system and the randomness, the stochasticity, the changes that we can see in a single cell over time. And then, you know, that notion of a bridge as it's being built, now adapting to the rain. I mean, imagine if people who were building with steel had to also contend with that. Whereas in a cell, we do have to figure out, you know, we're building something with the DNA language, we're programming the cell, and then the cell undergoes these strange changes that we have to figure out and have to understand. So I see this as a tremendous opportunity to engage a broad range of people in answering or thinking about these questions. And so the curriculum that I've been teaching at MIT is largely based on this uncertainty of how do we engineer biology. It is an experiment, this idea of synthetic biology. Can we do it? What does it take? What are the frameworks and answers and thoughts that we can bring to bear on this? I think it's been tremendously interesting for my students, and they seem to learn, they seem to be motivated to do the really hard work of learning. And learning is hard work, and I appreciate that. I worry that sometimes teachers forget that learning is really hard, and learning is a really hard endeavor. I think synthetic biology motivates it, and I think actually Karen is a great example of how learning some things about synthetic biology really motivated her to do something maybe out of her comfort zone, and actually now to make a tremendous contribution, I think, to the field through the graphics that are included in this curriculum. So the things that I've been teaching at MIT are collected at a under the framework of something called Biobuilder. So if you go online and look up biobuilder.org, it is a nonprofit organization that collects my teaching materials and the teaching materials of teachers in synthetic biology so that people have access to these questions and the ongoing efforts in the field. We have a couple of things, I'll mention a couple of things and then turn it over to Karen. I am coming back to New York in a few weeks to teach a workshop at Rockefeller. If you would like to participate or have teachers who might like to participate, there are a couple of flyers up at the front. Please take them. We still have a couple slots to fill for the Rockefeller workshop. If you would like to participate, it would be lovely. And then the other resource that is available for engaging with this is a new book that just was published a week and a half ago that Karen and I and two other authors worked on called Biobuilder, Synthetic Biology in the Lab. Karen will talk about the process of engaging with that and what attracted her and the learning and work associated with that. We had intended to have a number of copies here for you if you would be interested in purchasing them. We only have a few copies that were delivered. If you'd like to buy them, that's fine. And if you would like to buy it at a later time and have a pretty bookmark from Karen signed in it, me sign the cover or whatever, we have some of these up at the front. You can put your name and address on the back and we will sign it. And if you go on to the PayPal site or whatever and buy it, we will send it to you. But it is here for you to look at and see if it's of interest to you, but I would like to turn it over to Karen and have her talk about the process of working on this book together.
Thank you. First of all, I'd just like to say that this book was so much fun to work on. Natalie is an amazing person and an incredible teacher, and I'll explain more about that later. I am not a biologist at all. I'm a designer and an artist, and I love science, but I'll explain a little more about that later. I'm a creative director. I used to work in marketing and advertising. I guess sometimes I still do, but I think it actually works as a handle. To me, it encompasses art design and curation. As far as art design goes, I'm really interested in natural subject matters, naturalism, anatomy, birds, just different kind of like animal behavior, things like that. But I'm also really interested in public outreach, and that's where the curation comes in. And I'm really a fan of like on-site experiences and places like gym space, places where you can get your hands involved and get your hands really dirty. I'm also a member of South by Southwest of the board of the Interactive Festival, and I hosted a few events in the past that were focused on the intersection of art and science, and it evolved into like the Biohacker Meetup. So that was a pretty fun thing that was there, and a wide array of people showed up, some biologists, a lot of people who were just curious about it. So there's a broad range of people here who have, it's a very limited knowledge to very expansive knowledge. So how do you interact with people of that broad of a range? I also hosted an event series called the Peer Systeming, and there are a few people here tonight who have spoken at my event, which is really awesome and exciting. We've had, people from Gen Space, of course. OkCupid, BuzzFeed, we've had makers, hackers, FBI folk. Our mantra is science, exploration, beer. Because we feel like people, when they're in a relaxed environment, are more receptive to new ideas. So that's kind of the goal of that. At the Empiricist League, I met Wyeth Marshall and Daniel Grushko, who's one of the founders of Gen Space. And through meeting Dan, the three of us and Marie Barshai worked on an art exhibit called Cupcakes Grow. I think maybe some of you guys might have gone to that. This was a few years ago, but it was the first bio art exhibit in Brooklyn. So that was really awesome and fun to do. These are some shots from the exhibit. We did an exhibit at South by Southwest where we did a GMO bacterial unicorn. It was a great success. We had 200 people painting on petri dishes and this modified bacteria, and this is actually my sister painting here, and those are some of the tiles. So everybody was given a number and a color, and they could just paint whatever they wanted. So this is the final mosaic. You kind of see, these are a few selected tiles, so people just painted whatever they wanted. One of the things that we wanted to include in the exhibit was an example of bacterial photography. And I knew that through Dan that Natalie was going to be teaching her bacterial photography class at MIT. So Wyeth and I got up super, super, super early in the morning and went and observed the class. And at the end of the class, she let us, try our hands at some bacterial engineering, some bacteria photosynthetic. So here she is teaching, and she's drawing the circuit up on the board. And I think that this, it's crazy, you never really know when you're going to hit a eureka moment, but when she started drawing on the board, I was like, as a visual person, I was like, oh my gosh, that's so cool, it's a visual, you can actually, it's a circuit, you can actually tweak it, I can't even put it into words. But anyway, these are our plates. That's my unicorn and Wyeth's Hegel's octopus. We put them in the bacterial dark room. And this is what we got. Nothing. So I was like, oh man, that was really cool, but it's a shame that it didn't work. But she was nice enough to share some that did work. And I just started thinking about what happened? Like, what was supposed to happen? How did the steps that I took in the classroom, in the lab, how would they come to make this? So I sat down with a scientific paper, gave up and started color coding repetitive words and just sort of figured it out that way. And then I showed it to Oliver, who was very kind enough to spend like 20 minutes with me, like looking at me strangely and saying, what are you doing? But he helped me shape it up into a way that it actually would make sense to a biologist, which was great. And so this was the final output, and Natalie saw it and asked me to help her out with this amazing book. And so, of course, I said, absolutely. But that's okay. So it was an amazing collaboration. And I really got to get a great idea for how you would visually depict, you know, the systems engineering of synthetic biology, you know, like topic area, systems, you know, parts and devices, and then DNA, right? The devices and parts. Yeah. How do you create that analogy that will make sense to people who are not biologists? So we worked with Rachel Bernstein. She was on the team, an amazing writer and journalist. So if you kind of break it down into like, if you're going on a vacation, you think about where you want to go. Do you want to go to the beach? Do you want to go to the city? Do you want to go for a hike? So let's say you select you want to go on a hike. So you want to go hike the Half Dome. So first you've got to get to Yosemite National Park. Then you got to get to the Half Dome. Then you got to get a map and you have to get your gear, right? So that's a pretty good analogy for how you would think about systems biology, because if you end up deciding you want to go to a city and you go to the Chrysler Building and you have a map and a Half Dome, you're not going to really, you know, be able to get very far. So that was really interesting. And then Katie Hart, she's a Biobuilder master teacher, and she, for each of the labs, we created these posters that sort of break down the lab, what's happening on a microbial level, and then also what you actually do in the lab. So she saved me, you know, months on my couch by drawing these little charts out, and we worked together on making them, finessing them, and making them more, easy to digest. So this is the final bacterial photography chart that is actually in the book. I feel really grateful and thankful that I got to work on this project. I think that that Natalie is an amazing teacher, and this book is really cool. So that's about all I have to say.
Warm, are there questions that folks
want to ask? Can you tell us how the book is broken down?
So this is written for a non-scientist and a non-engineer in mind. I run, as I mentioned, teacher training workshops, and this curriculum really came out of the way I teach teachers how to run synthetic biology classes in high school settings or early college settings. The first four chapters are foundational, really going through much of what Paul talked about, the notion of abstraction, the notion of biodesign, DNA assembly methods, bioethics, there's a chapter on bioethics as well. The last five chapters are the labs in Biobuilder, which include the bacterial photography lab, the formi lab, and other investigations that are based on unanswered questions that are raised as people have been trying to design and rationally build biological systems. So the front portion is fundamental matter, and then the second portion of the book is the experiments themselves, including frameworks for teaching them, and then protocols for carrying them out in the lab. And the beautiful posters and lab guides that Karen made, which are phenomenal. And those are, O'Reilly's been a wonderful publishing partner in this. The posters are freely downloadable online. The lab guides are freely downloadable online.
What was the most fun part of the book to write? What was the most fun and what was the most challenging?
I think the most challenging was the quoting. we talked about this earlier. That, to me, that was the most difficult just because I felt like as a designer, I should have a brilliant way to think to it visually. Yeah, I don't know. I feel like that's worth the iteration. But it was all fun, honestly. It was all fun.
We had a great process.
Yeah, it was all.
Yeah. But I felt like I really underutilized her talents as a graphic artist because drawing how you assemble DNA is really a lot about drawing circles and small enzyme sites. So she drew a lot of circles for us, a lot of colored circles.
That's a fun conceptual puzzle for
yeah.
me, though.
Yeah.
That to me was a lot more fun than,
right. Yeah, well, I don't know. So the really fun parts for me were seeing how she would visualize the content. I mean, she would come up with these beautiful visuals. When we talk about chassis design, you know, what organism are you going to put this DNA program into? She has a beautiful drawing of a DeLorean. I mean, it's just fabulous. And it's really fun. And some of it was hard, you know, but it was great. It iterative and really
experience of learning how to do this book really reminded me of the issue of science communication and the responsibility of scientists to tell people what we're doing and what we're doing. And you know, I was wondering now that you've had to take something like a scientist's mind and put it on paper, if you have suggestions about how to communicate, how to use imagery to communicate science.
As an artist, I would say it's give it a shot and let yourself be corrected. That's what I would do. But as a scientist, I would know. I mean, I feel like I said, grateful that she saw something in all of herself, something in my work enough to engage with me. So maybe it's just a matter of both sides being receptive to one another and understanding that there's a value and progress that can be made from the collaboration.
So just as an example to amplify that, I mean, Karen really is quite humble as an artist. And I don't know, who likes the cover picture on that Biobuilder, right? I really like it too. It's kind of like a steampunky kind of thing. We're thinking of making little plush toys, like hang off your backpack, and it would be really cool, right? The original cover that Biobuilder sent us had half a dozen tiny, hairy little microbes crawling all over the cover. And I looked at it and I went, this is going to horrify people. Nobody's going to want to touch that book, much less like pick it up and read it. And Karen really very thoughtfully approached the design of the cover and talked about why this would be a more appropriate, talked with the publishers about why this is a more appropriate visual. And so, I mean, that's just an example of not only her talent and her ability to really communicate, but her knowledge of what is effective science communication. So, yes?
If you look at this synthetic biology, it seems like a lot of tinkering.
Yes.
It's like the 70s work with transistors and stuff, but how much is actual theoretical research went behind it? Like, why it actually works? Why it lives?
I mean, I was attracted to synthetic biology because I do find it a very effective way to teach the life sciences, right? And this curriculum was co-developed with high school teachers. So when you try to build something, it is the quickest way to learn what you understand and what you don't, right? And so you can learn science by trying to build things and tinker with them if that is your mindset, that this is a way to discover. Is that not your question?
I mean, if this is like high school, middle school, how serious, how academic is it? Like, is it actually, like in science school, is it taken serious?
Oh, no, it's a hugely serious research. It's massive. I mean, it's sort of there are some very serious players who are trying to build this future technology.
And I think you can enter at many points. So you know, with this curriculum, it takes existing questions that the very serious synthetic biologists are asking, and takes a small chunk of them and makes them teachable. It takes those authentic questions. What cell type are you going to put this DNA in, and how do you decide? And makes that a question that can be addressed in a high school setting, in a middle school setting. And that data that's collected feeds back to the field to make those decisions. What is it about this cell type that does or doesn't work?
If I can put it in a different way, to a real kick up the backside of the biological community, because the way that we have sort of behaved, if you like, and how we, you know, characterized our, how we published, how we, we've been very remiss at basic things like standardization, you know, worrying that if someone uses a reagent of mine, a DNA plasmid of mine, you know, is that going to work the same in their lab as my lab? That, you know, for engineers, they worry about stuff like that, really worry about that. Well, I just don't care. So, right. Got my publication, I don't care, you know, pass the reagent, it works, right? And so, you know, in some ways, the labels is kicked back, should have kicked back, so someone's community. Sorry.
Yes. Well, I have, just adding on to that, and it's an interesting point, the way that I understand, and please pardon, this is the analogy I understand, synthetic biology. It's kind of like physics and engineering, right? So physicists do the theoretical, and then engineers will be doing the more applied way. And very similarly, I think that biologists will continue to do theoretical to your end, and then those discoveries will translate into applying things if there is large scale.
Absolutely correct. The only trouble is that a lot of the biomedical research is not reproducible. And you know, physicists and engineers, you know, whether you like them or not, their work is very reproducible. Because they error bars like that in an engineering department would be like, you know, you shouldn't be here. Right? In biology, it's like, oh, show an error bar. Thank God we showed that. It's ridiculous. It's completely absurd. It's got to change.
Is there one question? I'll get to you maybe afterwards. What was
your question? From what I've seen, there's a very strong connection between art, design, and synthetic biology.
Yes.
And I'm just wondering where that came from, because it doesn't seem, it's, I didn't expect to see it.
Yeah.
I think that. For me, it's exploring the unknown and kind of both. It feels a little more organized than I had thought, I guess. Even though I know that, you know, there are wild cards all over the place, but it's an exciting puzzle. It's creative, you know. It's a new form of material, a new medium. It's exciting and creative, you know, so that's.
So I think there is a creativity to the things you can build, so there's an art history to it naturally. I also think that as synthetic biologists, we have a particular challenge in that the parts that we're building with are microscopic. The cells that we're building are microscopic. And so we need visualization tools. We need ways to display our work that is maybe more engaging than a poster or more engaging than a table or a chart. And so I think there's a huge place for visualization of the work that we do and communication of it so that it can be accessible. I mean, I think there's an eagerness to have this accessible to a broad population, and I think that's also a challenge.
Not totally agree.
Yes. But it's a joy when you're working with people who are like-minded, I would say.
Yeah, it was actually an amazingly efficient process. We had a one-hour call every 2 weeks. We all had our action items after the call. We were, sometimes less, but definitely no more than 1 hour. And everybody was always on the call every single time.
Yeah.
So I actually think that formula made it go a lot more smoothly than it was on.
And we were very collegial in writing it. You know, Katie's ability to draft that poster was not something that threatened Karen, right? She didn't feel, oh, you're in my territory of visual dick. It was really a lot of back and forth for all of us, you know, it was great.
You both talked about the difficulty of working with a changing system. Are there ways in which that's actually a strength in that biology, that you have a system that's so classically attached? And what specific areas are those?
Very good question. So, you know, let's take on the opportunities potentially available for systems for engineering in engineering in a different way. The response and adaptiveness is a very interesting way of supply sensing and it's a new journey. It's a sort of low-hanging fruit, if you like, in synthetic ology. So a lot of people work on biosensors. So you can start building logic into biosensor systems and then using the adaptability of cells and some of their circuitry, which allows them to be very adaptable, refactoring that. So that's very useful. Actually using the adaptability of cells and sense of engineering them to adapt in a particular way is also very useful. So maybe having genetic circuits that can trigger sporulation, for example. So if you have a bacteria can sporulate and make form these little spores. So there are a number of biosensing projects that could benefit from the biosensor being in spore form. You can transport it. It's not going to be in temperature sensor data. Then you can bring the spores back in the sensing device as well. So there's a little program to sporulation. So engineering that in a way would be very useful. So yes, great. Yeah, it's like, you know, we can't ignore the natural biology. We have to engineer it and use it and maximize the opportunity. So yeah, very, very good.
I'd like to say, you know, my laptop, every time I open it, still has the same genetic, the same programs on it that it was when I closed it, right? But in a cell, you know, there are mutations that happen. We can look at that as a terrible bug in the system and something that we have to fight against. Or we can use it as a way to say, you know, what would nature tell us as an approach to getting closer to the system that we would actually like to build? So if we can build something that is near to what we're trying to design, and then allow evolution to bring it even closer, we're actually partnering with the unique aspects of the natural systems. Yeah.
In an engineering context, that would be called optimization.
Right, right, exactly. Yes.
So just from a more sort of political perspective, obviously you're saying that synthetic biology is like developing massively, and like it's having more and more of an impact on like daily life. I was just wondering where like the main funding comes from and whether it's government funding or whether like some technology is getting more like commercial in order for like investment in it from like a commercial perspective.
Very good question. Public funding is driven by the impact agenda. Every government in the world, if you look at its technology as a new technology, will want to fund its research base, be it academic, to maximize that opportunity that will then lead into translation of jobs and things.
Part of the biologists.
So, you know, so.
Government like one part of the biologists,
now aware. Yeah, and then there's a lot of private capital going into the opportunity of these new technologies. So it's a mixed funding model. I mean, political question is a, you know, are we making stuff for the broader benefit of society is a very complex debate.
It is.
I'm not sure.
All right, it's awfully hard. We'll be here to talk after. Let's take one more question maybe and then we'll take a break. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was wondering, going back to the reproducibility, are there any like specific like barriers that you can mention that are practical barriers to reproducibility or like, how we overcome that?
Did you say visibility or mutability?
No, reproducibility.
Oh, reproducibility. The physical barriers to reproducibility.
No, it's a mindset, actually, to be truthful. And I'm a biologist, because I know this. Biologists tell very good stories. You know, when we describe our scientific work and publish it, and I hope it's low. I'm going to lose all my colleagues now. I've lost them. Biology is very good at telling stories, so when you read a lot of literature, it's changing now, but historically it was you would frame an experimental story which you would tell, right? So, you know, I discovered something in a cell that does something fundamentally, and you would tell that story. So the data you get is not necessarily in a time frame. You might have got data within the project or the end of the project, but then you mix it all up and you push it into a story that you tell. Yeah, I think the problem with that mindset is that, you know, that's why there are some really good storytellers, and there are less good storytellers. They know how to tell stories, and that's happened historically in biology. So it's a mindset. you know, to get a postdoc or a PhD student or a student to go and measure things, you know, a lot of times and get those error bars really, 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 really tight, then it's not easy. Yeah, so automation is the way. Yeah, so that's what we're pushing. Automation, standard processes. When you measure something here, we use the same protocol, we measure over there, we might use different equipment, so metadata, all the metadata, how the settings of instruments were, you know, what temperature, what were the slits on the fax machine, blah, blah, blah. That's not fun.
Just to sum up, I think synthetic biology is really trying to make biology into an engineering discipline, and the opportunity in education is to have the way we learn better resemble the way we actually practice this work. And so maybe because of the heat and the time, would it be okay if we took questions up here? Everybody is welcome to stay as long as it takes. So.
Well, also, for anybody who's interested, be able to go upstairs to the 7th floor to take a look at the Gen Space Laboratory if you are interested.